Adding fuel to a fire is usually not a good thing, especially when it comes to forests that are already wrecked by massive fires every year. So setting any fire on purpose doesn't exactly sound like a good idea. But these people here pouring fire on the ground, they're actually saving these forests from those devastating, out-of-control fires we see on the news. Because over time, we've learned that forest management isn't always about saving the trees. Sometimes it's about burning them. Indigenous communities studied the effects of natural periodic fires, and they've been practicing controlled fires for centuries. Before colonizers learned from these communities, forests were managed in ways that were ultimately harmful and made the fire problem even worse. While many indigenous communities embraced fire as part of the forest, the US government took a different approach. After a massive fire known as the Big Burn of 1910 destroyed huge swaths of land in and around northern Idaho, the US Forest Service launched an aggressive fire suppression campaign.
That campaign has lasted and persisted in many forms over the decades and has basically removed natural fire from the landscape.
But since then, we've learned about the many benefits of natural fires in forests. So this campaign was straight up a huge problem. Before this whole fire is bad movement, fires were super common and could be categorized in three ways: low, moderate, and high severity. Most natural fires were low or moderate, with the occasional high-severity fire that created gaps in the forest, which was actually good. Fires created patchy forests with a diversity of conditions. We got open meadows and shrubby areas and sections with large fire-resistant trees.
Following that period with European settlement, there was large-scale logging of the forest. So much of the old-growth forest was cut down in big swaths.
For over 400 years, though, loggers had chopped down thousands of acres of trees until the 1970s when Forest Service lands were marked for preservation.
What the Forest Service inherited in many cases was a very unhealthy forest full of lots of young trees, overcrowded, very dense conditions. Those conditions have played themselves out and resulted in large severity wildfires of the kind that we've been seeing in recent years.
When you picture a healthy forest, you might think of something that looks like this. A bunch of very similar looking trees all bunched together, but this isn't quite right. Healthy trees need much more space than this.
Before the forest was cut down and then fire suppressed, we typically had somewhere between 30 and 50 very large trees per acre. Today, what we have is tree densities that are more like 300, 500, and even 800 trees per acre.
Amidst so much competition, the trees that can't get the resources they need die and fall over, turning into ground fuel. Today's forests have way too much of this ground fuel, so when a fire sparks, it can burn through more than 3 feet of fuel on the forest floor, which can then quickly escalate into a high-intensity fire. And high-intensity fire ruins forests. The trees need a much longer time to grow back, and the soil quality it's just wrecked. Huge fires this size are also dangerous for humans, burning homes and causing evacuations. They also produce disease-causing smoke and contaminate our water sources. So we need not too much fire, not too little fire, but just the right amount.
The Sierra Nevada as a whole is a fire-adapted forest. It needs good fire. But when we look back at the scientific literature, reconstructing some of the deep history of these forests, what we learn is that most of the fires were what were classified as low or moderate severity wildfires. There was actually a very low percentage of wildfires that were in that high severity class prior to the clear cutting and the fire suppression that we've talked about.
The Big Burn of 1910 caused a campaign that literally extinguished all kinds of helpful low-intensity fires. But now, experts are working to put those low-intensity fires back into the forest. Enter the Nature Conservancy, the U.S. Forest Service, and their partners who have been working to restore the natural state of these forests through what's known as prescribed burns, or controlled fires. So we went to check out one of these prescribed fires in the French Meadows area of the Sierra Nevada.
The goal of the prescribed fire, first and foremost, is to reintroduce beneficial fire to the landscape. And we want to simulate a low intensity fire. To meet that objective, there's a prescription that is planned ahead of time that our firefighters and our fuels officers have to meet.
Literally a prescription to help the forest heal. Ideally, all forests that need it would get this treatment, but in this case, the Forest Service chose the French Meadows area to protect the local reservoir and water source from a major fire. In addition to choosing a good location, a lot goes into making sure that conditions are perfect to burn off that ground fuel, but not let the fire get out of control.
One of the ways that we can measure if we're in ideal conditions to initiate ignitions on a prescribed fire is through the fuel moisture of the sticks out here in the forest. The fuel moisture, how much actual water is in these, how easily they kind of snap and break, lets us know if they're ready to burn to meet our objectives.
You want there to be some moisture so the fire won't burn too hot, but not so much that it doesn't spread at all. So the firefighters have to both start the fire and keep it from spreading out of control.
We always first try to use roads or ridge lines or rocky outcroppings. And if necessary, firefighters will prep an area. They'll actually build containment line. There's some containment line behind me where they're removing all of the hazardous fuels, all the burnable material to stop that progression of a fire.
There are all kinds of benefits to these prescribed fires. Burning off that excess ground fuel, protecting communities and water sources from high intensity fires, and just upping the overall forest health by restoring nutrients to the soil and bringing carbon from those excess trees back into the soil. But not everyone is a fan of lighting fires intentionally, especially after all those anti-fire campaigns. Nearby communities also worry that these burns will decrease air quality.
Smoke is an ever-present part of prescribed fire planning. In advance of doing a prescribed fire, there are professionals who actually model the different environmental conditions that will help lift the smoke up and disperse it out and away from populated areas.
I will say this, in a large, high-intensity wildfire, the amount of smoke is magnitudes greater than if we kind of nickel and dime our way through the smaller prescribed fire. Each prescribed fire does have a measurable amount of smoke. It is far less smoke input and carbon release into the atmosphere than those high intensity fires. And again, more prescribed fire now equals less high intensity wildfire later.
One more time, more prescribed fire now equals fewer high intensity fires later. In this world where the climate crisis is very much a reality, we have more frequent and more devastating wildfires. Even though setting forest fires might not be intuitive, prescribed burns have worked for millennia and are still one of the best solutions for managing our forests well into the future.
So this portion of this watershed is now going to be more resilient to drought, disease, beetle infestation, and most importantly, maybe it's going to be more resilient to high intensity wildfire, and that's those wildfires that we see in the news.
My name is Neba of Notes by Neba, and this has been Seeker's Impact of Everything. Let us know if there's an episode topic you want us to cover, and we'll see you next time. Thanks for watching.